There are miniature ways to continue to advance human rights to the people within their vicinity, near and far, in that regard. We have Stephen Mbida, who is on the ground in Mengo, to actually bring us up to speed with this event. A very good morning, Stephen Mbida. What's the latest?
You know, Romeo Busiku, there is a function happening down at Wakiso, that is at Wakisha grounds, and this is just part of the commemorations for the World Human Rights Day, and that is for Wakiso District. But I've gotten in touch with the lady who has been at the fore of fighting for human rights, but also defending those who need legal justice, and she is none other than Dr. Sylvia Nambiru Mukasa. She is the executive director of Legal Aid Service Providers Network, who happens to have had her birthday yesterday. I think it was a right for me, my right, I had a right to share a birthday cake from La Cipnet and from her family. Good morning to you, Doctor.
And I'm still waiting for one from NTV. Good morning, Stefan, and our viewers on NTV. A very good morning.
Thank you so much for allowing to speak to me this morning as we commemorate the World or International Human Rights Day. And just to begin with, we are talking about ending inequalities and also advancing human rights. But the situation generally in Uganda, how do you say it is? Are we advancing? Are we stagnating? Or are we going back on issues of protecting and observing human rights?
Okay. Thank you, Stefan. I'll just use my own eyes to assess the situation and experiences that we are having in Uganda. We can say to some extent there is some progress, but also on a bigger extent we are really stagnating, or even we are worsening in some aspects. If we are to look at the human rights trends right from said December 2020 and then going into the time of elections in January and all those months that that came, and then going through the COVID terrain, all the upheavals that we have had to suffer with during all this period, the lockdowns, many factors. Some are our own making, but others are external pressures and all things beyond our control. So we can say that we are, to some extent, stagnating and all even worsening.
What exactly caught your attention 2020, November 2020, December, and January, and also this time, that you may point out exactly that you say this is making us at least stagnate in the position of trying to advance human rights?
When we go to the principle of equality in human rights, and that's why the theme is equality, reducing inequalities and advancing human rights. So when you look at equality, you look at it in a sense of what human rights are categorized. We have the economic and social rights, but we also have the political, civil rights. In the area of civil and political rights, we are going to go into the democratic governance processes, and you will see a lot of inequality coming and manifesting, especially in terms of making and giving equal opportunity to all those who want to stand for leadership. They are affected in a number of ways. You find a category that is affected because they don't have resources. They're making a politics, monetizing politics. So they don't have enough resources to compete with those who have. And that alone puts them out of the game. And they cannot easily exercise their right to freedom of exercising themselves to be in governance. But also we have an element of those that are in power and those that are wanting and struggling to come into power. So the inequality came in such a way that those that were in power kind of pressed down those that were struggling to come in power. And as a result, you see continuous arrests and arbitrary arrests of political activists. And then the demonstrations said of November that led into killings. And then we come into January, as people were, even before January, as people were convening rallies, and they would be arrested indiscriminately. The media would be affected by being injured in the process and in the line of duty. Their rights are not respected. They are assaulted. Some of them ended up losing life. Then we see others being arbitrated. The drone became the issue in Uganda. The disappearances came in. For the first time, we began to see enforced disappearances. So what am I trying to say? We saw it more on the side of the youth that we are belonging to a certain type of political dispensation suffering. So the inequality there, if I am to speak to the theme, came in for those who have power over, they did not allow those who didn't have power to exercise their right to a political engagement, which is more of a mutual. Then when it comes to economic and social rights, COVID has affected us so much. In the social life, I'm going to talk about gender-based violence. COVID has enhanced and increased gender-based violence. Mm-hmm. This time around, men and women are affected. Children are more affected because of the lockdown. We see the lockdown of, especially the second wave, where children have never gone back to school since then. That alone is a violation of a right to education. And it is increasing inequality. The halves are having their children in the second.
Digital learning or
digital
online
learning. The poor are down. The girls are getting married at an early age. They are getting pregnant. Right now, the statistics from UNFPA speak about 70, and not all the districts, but a few districts, 70,000 girls that have become pregnant or gotten pregnant during this period. What does that mean? Increasing inequality, drop out of school, getting into domestic violence because they are being married off very easily. So the social rights of the children or the girl child has been affected. The men dropping out of employment. And because they have dropped out of employment, they are also facing violence, sometimes which is psychological and being meted.
Which even translates into the homes where,
exactly.
where the father has been the provider,
yes,
for the homes.
Yes.
That means even the, those in the homes,
yes,
are going to even to suffer or,
mm-hmm,
even have that gap. It's going to widen.
It has widened. So the unemployment rate has widened, and it has affected more the men who are originally in our context considered to be the breadwinners. The violence in the home, because of the lockdown, people have stayed together. So when you look at the police annual report, you are going to find that domestic violence, rape, defilement, all those are rights that have affected the social well-being, and those are social rights. And we're talking about inequality.
Doctor, you've been in the circles of the judiciary, serving there, and also even now as a lawyer, and of course giving the legal advice and legal support to many victims, mm, or even those who need it. Mm. When you look at the lockdown, many people were arrested, they were not even able to be prosecuted because some lawyers were not even, they weren't even able to access lawyers. Others are still even in prison up to now, waiting to hear their cases. Sometimes even you people in the judicial circles also make it even impossible for people to get justice. Mm-hmm. This is also an indication of abuse of human rights.
Yes, and that speaks to the procedural rights of suspects, if we go into mainly the criminal component, because when COVID came in, we received the presidential directives and suspension of most of the activities, including the court. Lawyers were not considered essential. Courts were asked to operate at minimal. And therefore, we ended up having many people remanded, and we added on already on the burden of already the congestion in prisons. So the numbers had to hit. I'm told from 50,000 plus that there can be, that was already in the prisons. The recent statistics speaks about 60,000 and plus of prisoners, and majority of these were those that were arrested because they were violating the standard operating procedure. Simple, not putting on a mask, walking to work because they've said stay home. So many were indiscriminately arrested, but there were no courts to hear them. And what does that mean? Again, inequality, because when I'm in prison, my liberty is constrained. I cannot be able to go home and do and survive or make ends meet. And then also the right to procedural right, the right to fair and speedy trial was very much violated during 2020, mm-hmm, because of these developments. Mm-hmm. And many people who are languishing in prison, they cannot access bail. You know, and even where bail is, sometimes the conditionalities cannot allow them because they will either increase the amount of money for you to pay, or you need a lawyer. The lawyer you could not access. So we saw increased violation of a right to fair and speedy trial or a right to access justice.
Okay, we cannot keep on lamenting because this, we as individuals or human rights or even human beings, the police leaders, the parliament and everyone is concerned, even the community leaders, the police and everyone. Mm-hmm. Now that we are even commemorating this Human Rights Day that is commemorated worldwide, what needs to be done, where are the gaps that need to be fixed as we move ahead so that the mistakes that have been committed in this previous year, mm-hmm. maybe they're not committed in the coming years. When it's been done, especially now that even Parliament is talking about even the issues of bail or no bail.
Okay, first of all, we need to correct the wrongs. And some of these, we do them not because we don't have the legal framework in place, we do them because we have impunity. And as a result of impunity, especially of law enforcement agencies, then we get this. So when we celebrate human rights, we are raising awareness internationally, and we are reminding ourselves as duty bearers, we are reminding ourselves as policymakers, we are reminding ourselves as law enforcement agencies, that look here, human rights since 1948, with the Declaration of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, have been very important at the center of reducing inequality because they are what makes a human being wholesome. So we need, first of all, to look at ourselves internally, a keen revelation of individuals and institutions. What did not go right? Why was it not right? Is it skilling that the law enforcement officers don't know what they are supposed to do? Is it impunity that we punish the perpetrators? First of all, we need to be accountable to the people of Uganda by punishing the perpetrators. Efforts are being made, but they are not enough. We now have the Uganda Human Rights Commission. It has to correct the wrong, and we want to invite everyone who was affected that now the Uganda Human Rights Commission is in place to come and report violations so that the perpetrators can be brought to book and also people compensated for the suffering they went through. We need to correct the health system because people need access to health. We need to look at the vice now, which is GBV. Our children need to go back to school as a matter of priority and ensure that we reduce. And the children who got pregnant, we need to correct them because we are responsible. We need to create an environment to enable children to go back to school even when they have given birth.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sylvia Nambiru Mukasa, the Executive Director for Legal Aid Service Providers Network. Of course, today is Uganda is joining the rest of the world in commemorating the International Human Rights Day. Keep it here on NTV. Back to you, Ramya Busiku, in the studios.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, too.
Much, Mr. Mbide, for that update. And of course, we are observing the International Human Rights Day. It is also the International Human Rights Defenders Day. We'd like also to shine a light on the young human rights defenders who have been grappling with the lockdown restrictions.